4 crore rupees. That was the amount I was offered as a remote software developer in my last job. I mean, not exactly that. You can see the exact distribution in the video linked in the description, but you get the idea. The point of this engaging hook is to tell you, one, that remote software development is an actual career these days. I've been doing it for 2.5 years now. Why it sort of picked up, and what are the 6 prerequisites/hacks that are good to implement in your workflow if you want to become a remote software developer. These are things I slowly and steadily learned when I became a remote software developer. I did not know this before when I was working an on-site job. None of these are things I was born with or knew when I was doing an on-site job. These are things I've learned and inculcated over the past 3 years. And in this video, I wanted to share some of these with you guys. These are super important if you're thinking of becoming a remote software developer in a foreign company, not from India. So with that, let's get right into the video. The first point is removing the language barrier. Unfortunately/fortunately, you have to make sure you're really good at English. You don't have to be the best in the world, but when you're working remotely as a software developer, even though your job is extremely backend, you don't have to talk for a living, you don't have to sell a product, you still need to communicate well on your pull requests and communicate with the team during standups. So the first point here is make sure you're able to comprehend the British accent. This is important because when you're giving your first interview, if you keep asking them to repeat themselves, it's sort of a yellow flag. These are not big tech companies and there are no laws, labor laws to not hire you based on your communication gap. They will purely not hire you if you're not able to communicate well. I remember in an interview of my own, we were interviewing a very nice Chinese person, but he wasn't able to communicate well and we had to basically ditch him in a very old company. So unfortunately, this becomes sort of a barrier, and especially a big barrier if you're primarily talking in Hindi in India. Back home, even I speak Hindi and Punjabi. But when you're communicating with clients, you need to be sort of fluent in English. A few hacks that you can implement are, one, watch a lot of English movies so you can comprehend the English accent well. And two, start talking to your peer group in English. I know it's a little weird/awkward to talk in English with friends you've always talked in Hindi and Punjabi with. But find a group of people who want to learn remote software development or become remote software developers. And with that group, only talk in English. Slowly but surely, you'll become pretty good at it. You don't have to be the best, but you have to be good enough for them to comprehend your accent and for you to comprehend theirs. With that, let's move to the second point. This is a slightly controversial topic. It's called adjusting your time zone. Most probably when you're working as a remote software developer, you're working for a US or UK based company and you're adhering to their 9 to 5, because most people over there usually start their day at 9 and end their day at 5. Your standup is most probably going to lie somewhere in the middle there. And that means you'll have to adjust your time zone a little bit. Now, a few things to keep in mind here. I personally work in the US time zone completely, which means I sleep at 3-4 a.m. in India time. You don't have to do that. All you have to make sure is, one, initially when you're joining the company, try to adjust it a little bit. Try to make sure you're not changing the schedule of the team once you're joining. Slowly but surely, once you become an integral part of the team, talk to your manager, communicate that the stand-up timing does not work very well for you. People are extremely understanding when it comes to time zones. These are extremely asynchronous jobs, so they understand that you have to sleep at 9 p.m., 10 p.m. Just make sure you communicate that well slightly after you join the company. Don't communicate that upfront is what I feel. Again, extremely controversial. Do what you have to. But if I was you, if I was starting a remote job right now, I would first accommodate myself to the time zone of the team. And in a month or two, when I'm extremely comfortable with everyone, when I've proven my worth sort of in the team, I would talk to my manager if I don't feel comfortable with the time zone and move it around a little bit. You can always find a 15-minute slot somewhere in the middle unless you're like completely distributed around the world. And that 15-minute slot is what you need to synchronously communicate with your team. Other than that, you're most probably working on your own and your work is what matters. Your pull requests are what matter. It does not matter how much you've talked or how well you talk. What matters is how much code you've pushed in. And for that, and you can do that on your own time, doesn't matter if it's the US time or UK time. One thing that might happen is one of your bugs may cause a production issue and you might be sleeping in the Indian time zone. So that's another reason for you to sort of move your schedule a little bit, but don't do it at the cost of your health. Only do it if it's not affecting you or if you like working very late like I do. If not, just work in the company for a month or two and then let them know you'd like to work in a more asynchronous fashion. With that, let's move to the third point, filling your CV with big tech. Now, this is again very controversial, But I personally feel if you have some sort of a stamp of a Google or a Facebook on your resume, it doesn't have to be a full-time job, doesn't have to be a full-time internship either. Even if it's Google Summer of Code, it's super impactful when you're trying to apply for a company from India in the US where they don't know anything else about you. They don't understand colleges. They don't know what an IIT is, but they do know what big tech is. So if you've worked at Google, if you've interned at Amazon, or if you've done Google Summer of Code, it sort of helps to instill some confidence in them when they're hiring you, because they know that Google was smart enough to screen you and hire you. And hence, it gives them some sort of confidence while hiring you. Again, this is not important, definitely not necessary. A lot of people make it purely based on their skills. And in the end, skills are what matter. But if you have a summer that's free, if you can take out some time and maybe prepare for Google Summer of Code, I would strongly suggest you do it. It can help in your resume, especially when you're applying for that first job. Once you get a remote job, it's very easy to hop from one place to the other. But when you're trying to get that first job, there is some friction that comes if you don't have any other remote job in your resume. So a remote internship like Google Summer of Code is super valuable. And even big tech names like Amazon, Facebook can help instill some confidence in your clients. If you can, definitely do it. If not, it's all good. Your skills are all that matter. With that, let's move to the fourth point. Remember that your college does not matter. The tiers that you've created in India for colleges, tier 1, tier 2, tier 3, may be impactful or helpful for a bunch of things. Maybe there are a lot of disadvantages to being a tier 2, tier 3 student. I cannot speak for it. I went to an IIT. But especially in remote jobs, it does not matter at all, because these companies don't know what an IIT is. When I tell people that there is an examination where a million people appear and 10,000 make it in, people are sort of surprised and then they forget about it. They don't even know the name. Hence, the college is something no one looks at. They just need to sort of look at some degree in computer science that sort of helps. Again, that's not also very important. But if you have some computer science degree, doesn't matter from what college, it's enough for them to filter you out. And from there, your skills are all that matter. So just get out of this trauma of being from a tier 2 or a tier 3 college. I know a lot of people who are currently in college, in tier 3 colleges, making 100K in a remote job from India. And I know a bunch of people who are from tier 1 colleges and are still going to, say, an Amazon for an intern, which is also great. But I'm just saying, if a remote job is what you want, your college really doesn't matter, purely because these companies don't understand colleges in India and the colleges' scales that we have created. What does end up mattering is, one, your ability to hustle, because it's not easy to reach these companies for anyone. For tier 1, tier 2, tier 3 college students, these companies are not visiting campuses. So you have to actively reach out to people irrespective of what college you're in. So how much you can hustle, how much you've already contributed to open source, and your communication skills are super important, much more important than what you're studying in college and which college you went to. With that, let's move to the fifth point. Again, controversial. I feel like all my points are slightly controversial here. So forgive me, Bajrang Dal Gang. This is not, I don't promote this lifestyle and I don't want to be caught up in some sort of controversy. But the fifth point is, don't be the bare minimum guy. What does that mean? Again, only do this if you feel comfortable. But the bare minimum guy is the person who does what he's told to do, basically clocks in 40 hours and then checks out at the end of the week. That is great if you're working in big tech. That's sort of the norm in big tech. You're supposed to work your 9-to-5 and bring your whole personality to work and eat very well on campus and get massages. And that's a great lifestyle, but that's not the lifestyle if you want to become a remote software developer. You have a bunch of other benefits, like you're working from the comfort of your home, you're moving around, you can work from anywhere, and no one really is sitting on your head. You don't have to go to the office commuting an hour a day one side, an hour a day the other side. These are the benefits. What are the downsides? The downsides are that you have to sort of overperform a little. The reason is no one is keeping a check on you. No one is asking you to come to the office. So it's expected that you're giving out the outcome of a normal full-time employee plus a little bit more. Why a little bit more? A little bit more because, as I said, no one's keeping a check on you. So it's always good to be the person who's contributing more than he's expected to. There's a very nice saying that says the man who does more than what he's paid for will eventually be paid more than what he does. And I've seen this personally very closely in my career. In my first job, I was making just 100K, but I was overperforming. In fact, I started at 70K and in 3 months jumped to 100K because I was performing so well. I was not the bare minimum guy and I was poking my nose everywhere and cleaning things up and then moving from front end to back end, back end to cloud and covering all aspects of the business. And by the time I left from there, within a year, I was juggling offers of 200K, 300K, just because I sort of had the confidence of, okay, for 100K, I've given out the outcome of 200K. I can easily ask for 200K in the next company. and sort of grow from there. I still feel that this journey should never end. You should never be the bare minimum guy. You should never settle if you're a remote software developer. And this is a principle I follow till date. I would recommend you to do the same, especially if you're working remotely. Not just your career ladder or your compensation. This will help you a lot personally as well. If you're poking your nose everywhere and if you're genuinely interested in development and coding, you will be the guy who's doing more than what he's expected to. On a day-to-day basis in a job, you're only really expected to do one thing, a very specific thing, and it's very easy to get bored of it. Hence, if you're actually interested in computer science, I'm pretty sure slowly but surely you'll start contributing more than what you're expected to, and the effects it'll have in your career would be exponential. Trust me, you'll see it. With that, let's move to the last point. The last point is getting involved in global communities. This is a very abstract topic, but I'll give out a few concrete things you can do here. The first one is start reaching out to people. The good thing about tech is tech celebrities are very different than entertainment celebrities. It's very hard to get hold of Shah Rukh Khan, but it's very easy to get hold of someone like Vitalik Buterin. If you just tag him on Twitter, if you've done something in the Ethereum ecosystem, most probably, if you reach out to him, he will respond in some form or fashion. And that's true for all tech celebrities or software development celebrities, more specifically. It's very easy to access them. It's very easy to get their time. And hence, step one might be, try to go through a framework that you really like. For example, React. Maybe reach out to a React community or the actual developers of React and try to understand what their mindset was when they were creating it. And if you're trying to contribute to React, it's super helpful if you sort of know the community. Again, don't spam anyone, but there are open Discord groups out there for the React community, for the Redux community. Make sure you join them. Make sure you get out of your bubble of five friends that you have in college. If you want to work remotely, again, there is no real downside of having friends. I mean, I have friends, everyone has friends. But more specifically, if you want to become a remote software developer, you will need to sort of come out of that shell and find other people around you, people from all around the world. Trust me, the world is so big, and I realized this very recently. There are people and software developers in the US, Colombia, Nigeria, fucking everywhere. And if you can find a very nice group of people who all want to work remotely and are dedicated to this lifestyle of remote work, it'll help you a lot. Versus if you remain in that circle of people who want to, let's say, get into Fang, which is great, no downside. Fang is a great career option. But if you want to become a remote software developer and if you remain in that circle, I mean, I'm guilty of this as well. I went to an IIT and IITs are famous for campus placement days. And I was part of the herd and wanted to get an on-campus job. Back then, if I would have had friends, if I knew people who were working in Web3 or working remotely, I probably wouldn't have taken the decision of joining Goldman Sachs. So if you're still in college, you still have the time to decide what you want to do. And if remote software development is what you want to do, if you want to become a remote software developer, find people who want to do the same and don't get involved in the herd mentality. Don't get discouraged by friends around you who are making it to Google, Facebook, wherever. Trust me, as I've said before, I know people in colleges who are making 100K working remotely from India in remote software startups. You can be that person. You just need to find that path. And find that path, follow these six steps, make sure you're good in English, make sure you're contributing to open source, realize that your college does not matter, get involved in global communities, try to reach out to as many people as you can, and create a very nice close-knit circle of people who want to become remote software developers. Trust me, 6 months is all you need. You can find that first job. And once you have that first job, you can always hop from one place to the other. With that, I am extremely pumped. I don't know why I already have a job, but I'm extremely pumped for you guys. Go out there and capture the world.
If you need some motivation, I'm in Chicago right now and I keep traveling. I'm going to Dubai next. I was in Singapore before this. Remote software development is an actual career. You can make money and also travel the world if that's what you like doing. I like doing that a little bit. So don't worry about the flakiness of this career. I think it's pretty stable. And always, always remember, the person who does more than what he's paid for will eventually be paid more than what he does. With that, let's end the video and see you guys in the next one.